afternoon and welcome to Across the Fence. I'm Jolie Whitney. It's summertime, and as Ella Fitzgerald once sang, the livin' is easy. And nowadays, livin' means coming off the trail and doing a tick check for you and your furry friend. Climate change has brought more ticks to Vermont, which means more tick-borne illnesses like Lyme. And if the ticks don't get you, the mosquitoes will. And joining us today to talk all things ticks is Patty Casey, the Environmental Surveillance Program Manager for the Vermont Agency of Agriculture, Food and Markets. Welcome.
Thank you.
We're happy to have you.
Thank you.
And you must get this all the time. People growing up in Vermont might say, well, we didn't have ticks when I was younger, so why so many ticks now?
Yep, and I was one of those people that said that. But there has been a population explosion of ticks in the last couple of decades. And a lot of scientists attribute that to land use changes in Vermont. There's more open land, a lot more suburbanization, people putting yards in, a lot more what we call ecotones, which are the border between two environments, so woods and field, or your yard and a cornfield. And that has allowed the deer population to really flourish in Vermont, so there's a lot of deer in Vermont. Deer are not, they don't actually carry the diseases that ticks pick up, but they are a big host population for ticks. So a tick on its own can't move very far, but it can move a few miles on a deer, which has allowed the population to really, really expand in the Northeast. There's also a lot more rodent habitat now with people's gardens, people feeding birds, bird seed falling on the ground, chipmunks, mice. So those hosts have really been, their population has grown. So there's also a lot of invasive vegetation in Vermont nowadays, which can create a monoculture. It chokes out native vegetation. And underneath that very thick growth is a really nice temperate layer of, warm or cooler humid air, depending on the outside temperature. Protection from prey, so their birds and stuff can't get in there as easily to get the ticks. And there's also a lot of the hosts, so the rodents are under those that invasive vegetation. And then the other factor that we see having an effect on tick populations is climate change. So we have warmer shoulder season. So earlier in the spring, it's getting a little warmer, and then in the fall, it stays warmer a little bit later. Our winters are warmer. We've seen an annual temperature increase of 2 to 4 degrees in Vermont over the last 50 years. So there are warmer breaks in the winter. There used to be a January thaw, and now there's a lot of little ones, which allow ticks to emerge and start questing. Questing is how they find a host. So they grab onto vegetation with their back legs and they wave their front legs in front of them, waiting for a host to come along. So those climate change factors have really contributed to the population increase.
And what ticks are most commonly found in Vermont?
So the two that people are most likely to come in contact with are the deer tick, which is formerly the black-legged tick. And that tick is responsible for more than 99% of the diseases, tick-borne diseases, that are reported to the Vermont Department of Health. And the other one is the dog tick, which people around here call a wood tick, and they are not known to be vectors of diseases in the Northeast. The diseases that we tend to see in Vermont are Lyme disease, which most people are familiar with, and about half the ticks in the state are carrying that now. And then to a much lesser degree, we see anaplasmosis show up, babesiosis, and Powassan virus, which is can be a very serious illness, but it's extremely rare in Vermont. The other ticks in Vermont are a lot more secretive and very host specific. So we have woodchuck ticks, rabbit ticks, squirrel ticks, moose ticks, which are also called winter ticks. And there's a new record in Vermont, the bat tick, which is a soft tick. It's very different, and they can live up to 20 years.
Wow, so fortunately, we're not a woodchuck or a rabbit, so there are
only
a couple we have to worry about.
Yes, that's right.
All right, and you mentioned two different ticks that are pretty common, and those are relatively small. So when should I check for ticks if I'm going out?
Yep, that's a great question. So anybody who is outdoors in Vermont should check for ticks pretty much every day. The belief is that it takes about 24 to 36 hours to contract a tick-borne illness, and there's there are different beliefs about that, but the CDC and Vermont Department of Health have that as a guideline. So if you're checking every day, every 24 hours, you're liable to catch a tick that has attached to your body. Certainly, if you are outdoors in areas that are tick infested, in tall grass or brush in particular, leaf litter, I check immediately when I come indoors. I actually go out looking for ticks a lot, so I'm putting myself in places where I'm hoping to find them. When you come back in from being outdoors, remove your clothing, put it in the dryer on high for 20 minutes, and take a shower, which will wash anything off that's crawling on you. And at that time, you can do a full body tick check. And when you are outdoors, if possible, stay on the trails and check yourself often. So I do that when I'm looking for ticks. I check myself as well pretty frequently. You have to be vigilant.
And it's not just you, it's your clothes as well, as you mentioned.
Yes.
So yeah. Something people, I certainly don't always think about is my clothes.
Yeah, put them in the dryer. If they're dry, 20 minutes will do it. If they're wet, they should be in for at least a half hour on high.
All right, good to know.
Yep.
And if I find a tick, what's the protocol? Should I squish it? Should I send it in?
It's pretty tempting to kill them because they're pretty awful. and that's fine. You can crush them. You can flush them down the toilet, put them in alcohol. But what you can do is send them to us for identification. We have a passive tick surveillance program with the Agency of Agriculture. It's on our website, agriculture.vermont.gov. And we will identify the tick to species, sex, engorgement rate, meaning how long they may have been feeding on your body, and their life stage. Those are all really important things to know about. If you do start feeling unwell, and you go to your primary care person, you can say, I had the Agency of Agriculture identify the tick, and this is, I know what it is. So that may help guide any healthcare decisions that they wanna help you out with.
All right, and let's talk about mosquitoes now. Is diet the best defense, or are there other ways to prevent? Diet. Is DEET the best defense?
I was going to say.
I just eat a lot of garlic.
Yes, that's right.
I should say DEET. Is that the best, or is there something else you can do?
Well, DEET is, what we recommend is any EPA registered insect repellent, and there are a lot that do contain DEET. Some people don't like DEET, and there are repellents that don't contain DEET. So you can go online and Google and find some that are DEET free if you want to do that. We recommend covering up long pants, long sleeves, limiting dawn to dusk, dawn and dusk activities when mosquitoes tend to be most active. If you're trying to get rid of mosquitoes, you should empty any standing water that you have around your property. Dog dishes, kiddie pools, tarps on your wood pile, your eaves can get clogged up and hold water. You can treat areas on your property with, it's called BTI, it's a biological larvicide that you can get at the hardware store. They're called bits and dunks. You can put them in standing water and they will kill the mosquito larvae.
And that standing water is where mosquitoes, you said?
Mosquitoes breed, they lay their eggs, they need water to complete that part of their life cycle. And then the adults, once they're flying, fix any screens, broken door screens at your house. And we're just starting our surveillance now for mosquitoes. So we have a program where we look for them all year, all mosquito season, and we test those for diseases.
And you mentioned standing water, and we actually have some video of the Agency of Agriculture doing a slice tires program. And why are tires such a selling point?
And once we cut the sidewalls off the tires, they can still be used to weight tarps on feed bunks and on gardens. But they do not hold any water. So this is a program that we've been developing, I've been working on for 10 years, and we just got the machine last year. So we've done some events. We did Wheels for Warmth. We cut up over 1,000 tires. We did flood-recovered tires after the big flood last year. We did a project for the Upper Valley Land Trust Community Garden. And what we're working for is to get it out onto farms free of charge to farmers. But it's going to be a lending program where we deliver the unit, we train people to use it, we come and pick it up. and farmers can use it for a week or two. We're hoping to have this program up and running this year. I'm wildly excited about it. They're much lighter, easier to store, they don't smell bad, they're cleaner, so it's a really terrific option for
farmers. Sounds like a win-win.
Yeah.
And if I potentially have standing water on my property, how often should I try and drain it out?
Well, if you can drain as quickly as possible, mosquitoes can go from egg to adult flying in less than a week under the right conditions in Vermont, because nowadays with warmer temperatures and more extreme rain events that we're having, there's a lot more water. It can heat up quickly, and you can go very quickly to a big hatch of mosquitoes.
And if a viewer at home wants to learn more about ticks or mosquitoes, what kind of resources do you folks have?
Well, if you go to our website, agriculture.vermont.gov, we have a whole lot of information on our programs, how to submit ticks, and what surveillance we're doing at any given time of year we do ticks and then mosquitoes. And then the Department of Health has a great website, that's healthvermont.gov, and they have something called Be Tick Smart, where you can learn a lot more about how to protect yourself.
And you mentioned that surveillance and for both ticks and mosquitoes, but can you tell me some of the things you're looking for with mosquitoes specifically?
Yes, so we have over 100 trap sites around the state. We visit weekly during mosquito season, and we have them tested for West Nile virus, Eastern equine encephalitis. This year we're adding Jamestown Canyon virus, which is another mosquito-borne illness that is not quite as serious as the other two, but we would like to know that it's here, we believe it is. And we did have Eastern equine encephalitis show up in last year's samples in the northwest part of the state. So we're gonna be out early and have a heavy presence up there, and then also, you know, all along the Champlain corridor where we do tend to see Triple E show up.
All right, and in your professional and personal opinion, before we go, we have to know which is worse in your opinion, ticks or mosquitoes?
You know, ticks.
All right. For any reason, or just going vibes?
Well, they're just more, they're sneaky. They're sneaky, and there's a much higher likelihood of contracting something from them if they are able to attach. So.
All right, thank you so much for joining us today.
Yes, happy to be here, thank you.
And that's care of our Across the Fence for today. Thank you to all the folks working behind the scenes here at WCAX for making today's program possible. I'm Julie Whitney, check for ticks, and have a good one.